Well, it's the last event of the day, so we're going to do everything we can to keep it entertaining and lively. You know, I'm honored to be here today to participate in this year's California Summit. Having been involved with this summit now for more than a decade, I'm amazed to see how much impact the work the Milken Institute has had in California. It's no secret that the California economy is now facing many challenges. We've made progress, but we have a lot ahead of us. We face specific issues in terms of our pension funding and OPEB benefits. We have a very unhealthy dependence on a highly cyclical tax base, which is linked to capital gains. Our population per capita income is higher than the national average, but when you take into effect the cost of living, we have the fourth highest poverty level in the United States. At the same time, we're mired in politics. There are 18 statewide referendum on the ballot this November, with $500 million being spent on referendum campaigns. So how do we pull ourselves out of this mess? I'm happy to introduce our next moderator to help us figure it out. His commitment to keep California's state economy vibrant and thriving is demonstrated not only through this conference, but his large contribution to financing growth of our economy. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Milken and our panel members.
So good afternoon, and we welcome those watching us online throughout the state of California today. And we're excited to be able to focus on keeping California strong in a competitive global world. Now, with the strength of the U.S. dollar, as you know, California is back as the sixth largest economy in the world. And so I'd like to start with President Pro Tem Kevin DeLeon to talk about some of the ideas you have on keeping California strong in a competitive environment.
Well, thank you, Michael. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here with each and every one of you and to a worldwide audience with the live stream. Today, we are the fifth largest economy in the world, GDP. We just recently surpassed the United Kingdom, obviously England, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland, largely because of Brexit. And today we're the fifth largest GDP. I like to believe that with the policies that we have moved forward with a sense of intentionality, with a sense of purpose in California, in particular the clean energy space, that we have created a tremendous economic growth in California. In fact, in the month of August, a few months ago, we created about 40% of all jobs in the United States of America. And a lot of these jobs are in the clean energy space. We're putting people to work. We're making incredible investments in higher education. This year of 2016, there'll be 20,000 brand new enrollment slots that are open, both at the University of California system, arguably the most prestigious higher education institution in the nation, as well as the Cal State University system. So we're making large investments in human capital in California. We believe that the return on investment will be huge. Obviously, we have great deficits that we need to deal with, whether it's underfunded liabilities with regards to defined benefit pension plans, whether it's the issue with regards to transportation infrastructure. We still have challenges before us today, but I think that my colleagues in both the Senate as well as the Assembly and the governor, we have worked in concert with each other very closely, even a handful of Republicans in a bipartisan spirit, to make sure that we can move policies that really improve the human condition for all individuals. And obviously, our return on investment, I think, is being rewarded by being today the fifth largest economy in the world. That's just coming off the worst economic recession since 1929, when we had double-digit unemployment in California. Our credit rating was obviously not robust. It has improved, relatively speaking, in comparison to other states. But making the right investments in human capital in California, I think, has proven to be very prudent for California.
Well, thank you, and I and And the movement to fifth, obviously the weakness of the British pound, you know, has occurred, plus the weakness in the euro that's affected France and others at that time. So when you think about it, the fifth largest economy in the world, with China, Japan, Germany, and the United States itself as the first four, an unusual situation. Representative Mimi Walters, we're so excited to have an entrepreneur person with us on the panel. So one of the things we'd like to ask is, what is the appropriate role for a state, for federal government, and the private sector to sustain and grow California's economy, since you had served in the state government for a long period of time before going to Washington?
Well, I believe that government needs to stay out of the way of business and let, I'm a very much of a free market person. And one of our biggest concerns that we're facing right now of how we're gonna continue to be competitive is we need to have tax reform. We haven't had tax reform since 1986, since President Reagan was in office. And right now, our corporations pay the highest of any industrialized nation, and it's about a 35%. So what we're seeing happen is a lot of corporations are moving overseas, they're headquartering overseas, having their headquarters overseas, they're keeping their money overseas because it's too expensive to bring it back into America and to reinvest in America. And we need to have corporate tax reform. We also, I believe, need to not overregulate, and we've seen time and time again when there's an issue, government tends to go too far to correct the problem. And although we do need some government regulation, we need to make sure that we don't overregulate. And we see time and time again overregulation. And in fact, in California, and it's great that we're coming back, but in 2013 and 2014, we lost of a quarter of a million people out of the state. They left California. And while one sector might be doing well, we also don't have any manufacturing left here. And those are middle class jobs. So we need to have a balance when it comes to our business environment and when it comes to government intervention.
Well, thank you. And I think, Marcus, I'd like to go to you for a moment in the sense that when we reflect on what has caused this growth in the world's economy, the number one driver of growth has been the advances in public health and advances in medical research, accounting for more than 50% of all economic growth. And when we reflect on it, at our Center for Accelerating Medical Solutions, Faster Cures, it's really hard to estimate what changes have occurred here in the last century. When we think about life expectancy, in the first 4 million years of evolution, we only added 11 years to life expectancy. In the last 115 or so years, we've increased life expectancy by 40 years. And not just life expectancy, but the quality of life at the same time. So, Marcus, as you think about it, how is Blue Shield of California addressing the issues of long-term affordability in healthcare? Recently, we've seen a challenge here to the concept that it might be unfair to charge people more who don't participate in exercise programs, better eating programs, other types of programs. What would you say are some of the key issues that you're looking to address at Blue Shield?
Well, thanks, Mike. I think that I think about this in sort of three different ways. One, I think it's important to realize that not all, but a lot of that improvement in life expectancy and also in economic growth has been driven by tremendous improvements in public health. And when I think about public health, I think about, number one, education and access to economic opportunity, a sort of fundamental characteristic of society which has a healthy population. Then you have to address some of the environmental and social causes of poor public health. In the United States, in the last 30 years, we've actually had a tremendous amount of success with the tobacco overuse and tobacco epidemic, and I'm hoping that we can now start to make progress with the obesity epidemic, which is actually driven by a fairly similar kind of phenomenon primarily changes in the diet in the United States and a big increase in the excess and consumption of sugar and refined carbohydrates. And we're recognizing that now and taking action. And certainly Blue Shield is taking an active role in supporting that. We've also been very active in addressing another epidemic, that of the overuse of prescription drugs, particularly prescription opioids, which again is something that we've just seen develop in the last 20 years and probably is to some extent linked to the obesity epidemic, because obesity is a driver for pain, chronic pain, and depression and other conditions that increase the utilization of opioids. So at Blue Shield, we've seen about a 25% reduction in opioids dispensed to our members in the last year, actually, as we've really implemented a strategic initiative. And what's particularly interesting to me about that is that as that program has taken effect, we're also seeing a parallel reduction in hospitalizations and ER visits in that same population for all causes. So it's not just that they're not going in because of an opioid overdose, it's because there are all kinds of other things like accidents and falls and other issues that are not happening because they're on lower and safer doses of opioids or not on them at all. So that would be one way of thinking about this, Mike. Another key thing is that, frankly, to have a booming business climate outside of the healthcare sector, you want to have high quality and affordable healthcare. There's no question that a part of that big increase in longevity has been a tremendous improvement in healthcare technology and healthcare delivery in the last 50 years. But the challenge that's come with that is that healthcare is incredibly incredibly expensive. So one of the things that Blue Shield is doing, our mission is to ensure that all Californians have access to high quality care at an affordable price. We're partnering with provider organizations around the state, forming accountable care organizations, and implementing a variety of forms of value-based payment to try to really work with those providers to help them become really accountable for the triple aim outcomes of great health, affordable care, and a great patient experience. And we're making progress on that, but it's a long lift. And then my last comment would be that obviously California also aspires to be and is already, frankly, a health technology center in the world. We've lead the way in biotech, and with Silicon Valley and other centers of excellence like San Diego, we're also really making strides in digital health. And I think that another great opportunity for the state is to expand that work and really not only continue to lead in biotech, but also really grow our capabilities in digital health. When I think about the lunchtime presentation, we talked about autonomy. When I think about autonomy in healthcare, I actually look to a future when people are able to do a lot more for themselves with respect to healthcare and are less dependent on the sick care system to be healthy. And I think that the digital health technology and revolution really is going to enable that. I think the one last caveat I'd leave you with is that we really struggle with the disconnect between the cost of healthcare services and the value they create. And that actually is, number one, a symptom of an inefficient and poorly functioning market, but it's also creates a poorly functioning market. So one of the reasons healthcare is so expensive is because we pay a lot for technology and services which deliver relatively little value. I think there was a great article by Andy Grove some years ago in JAMA pointed out just how inefficient healthcare is in terms of creation of new value relative to the cost of the investment.
Well, Andy Grove was on one of our foundation boards for about a decade, and we focused on this issue. But one of the challenges we have in the United States, as you know full well, Mark, is as the United States is the most obese country in the world. And so when you compare levels of obesity to other countries in the world, you drag down resources. And Ross Duvall, who heads our research group, has put out that first report in 07 called An Unhealthy America, where it cost America more than $1 trillion a year, just the change in weight. So one of the things we'd love to do is just have Americans weigh the same as they weighed a couple decades ago, and we could reduce that cost. Senator?
I was going to add a couple things. Based on what the doctor just mentioned with regards to biosciences, and I believe that the fact that we're the fifth largest GDP in the world, I know, relatively speaking, the devaluation slightly of the pound and what's happening in Europe right now in the European Union.
Well, for us that have invested in the UK, that devaluation has been painful.
Very painful, very painful. I think we're the fifth largest economy in the world, not by pure luck and by pure happenstance, and not allowing the global factors to sort of dictate what happens in California, but because we have moved public policies with, again, a sense of intentionality and purpose, for example, in the clean energy space, where we are not a leader, but we are the leader in the world in the creation of jobs that you can verify, that you can quantify, and that you can measure, whether it's energy efficiency, whether it's renewable energies. So what are the big economic drivers or the potential ones in California? And when we talk about biosciences, because in California, we have some of the top research universities in the world. We have at least six of them, the top 20 in the nation. Obviously, we have Stanford, we have Cal, Caltech, UCLA, UCSD, and UC San Francisco.
So in supporting your point here, you can see here that California, of the top graduate schools in biological sciences in the United States, has 8 of the top 20.
Yes.
So.
And where I'm going with this is that for continued job growth, economic growth in California, especially here in Los Angeles, what we have lacked, University of Southern California, are trying to create an ecosystem, if you will, at the hospital with regards to biosciences. To me, this is the next frontier. If we, as policymakers, send the right signals to the market to invite the necessary capital, I think we've been successful so far because we get 60%, over half of all venture capital comes to California because of the environment that, in fact, that we have created. In fact, let me be very clear. We have created
more
jobs.
We want to show you that we have hundreds of people at the Milken Institute. When you say something working, immediately to create slides and put them up.
The Milken elves are up there, churning out the PowerPoint slides. But we get over 60%, over half of the venture capital comes to California. In fact, job growth, larger job growth than the two next leading states combined. And that is the state of Texas, as well as the state of Florida. So I think we're doing a good thing right now in California. We have a very functional legislative body, unlike, and Mimi and I are friends, and although we disagree in a whole variety of things across the spectrum, I mean, the dysfunction in D.C. is so deeply severe. We have succeeded in spite of what has happened or not happened in Washington, D.C., and this is a state, by the way, that doesn't get a dollar and above, but we get about 72 cents on the dollar. Therefore, California actually helps subsidize us a lot of other states, and ironically speaking, states that are red states, that are Republican, controlled state legislative bodies. Therefore, we're moving policies again, and I think the next frontier is the bioscience world, but especially here in Los Angeles, because we have UCLA, because we have Caltech, because we have UC Irvine, because we have Cedars-Sinai, because we have City of
Let's
Hope.
Let's add UCLA in there.
We have UCLA. I was getting there. I was getting to UCLA, But we haven't been able to tie it all in together. We haven't been able to tie it all together. And the former chair and CEO, a good friend, Jay, over at HealthNet, had said to me.
Jay Gellert.
Yeah, Jay Gellert. Jay said to me, like Boston, Mass, and Cleveland, he says, L.A. has the potential to be the premier health market on planet Earth. The leadership just has not been able to put its arms around this and bring it together because of all these incredible, institutions that we have.
Right. Now, I just want to, because you're the president of the Senate, I know you're also excited about Stanford and Berkeley and the strength that we have in Northern California also, right?
Oh, USC, obviously Stanford with the Cardinal here and okay. Cal Berkeley, but obviously the fine institutions we have here in Southern California.
So we're talking about both in the area of the country that has the most, in the world today, the most patents filed in the biosciences, happens to be the Bay Area. Mimi, I want to give you a chance so you can see they're number one in the world, San Diego, Los Angeles, et cetera. So we have these areas. So we've had this challenge a little bit. You've been in the state legislature. Mm-hmm. You've been in the House, you're in the House of Representatives. Why don't you compare and contrast that for us?
Yeah.
Well, it's way cooler being in the in Congress than it is in the state legislature.
And just so
you know, since I'm in the majority party, it's a little bit easier to get things done. And what we did do is we did make the R&D tax credit permanent, which it had not been permanent, and that helps in the bioscience area because these companies need to know that that R&D credit. They need to know that they can count on that credit. But I will only say one thing, and then I'll be quiet. We work very hard in the U.S. House of Representatives and in the Senate, and we've sent numerous bills to the president's desk, but we can't help it if he just won't sign them into law.
So let's take a look, just in closing this one point, at slide 59. Marcus, and I think it captures some of the points that you had made. What has caused this increase in life expectancy and quality of life, vastly improved sanitation, public health, and that is why we have a center for public health and a school of public health at the Milken Institute, development of antibiotics, obviously the challenges in the future are resistance to antibiotics, implementation of vaccines, progress against heart disease, probably, particularly in this country in the latter part of the 20th century, and this investment. Let's turn ourselves a little bit to finance. And Gabe, you've got enormous responsibilities there at Standard & Poor's. You know, how you rate the state of California dramatically affects over time the level of interest the state has to pay. How's California doing?
Well, I know everybody's been waiting to hear about the details of what goes into a credit rating. So, you know, now we're here. But what I was thinking about when I was hearing the remarks was that, you know, in the course of evaluating a state credit rating, the economy really is one of the key pillars of our analysis. And in California's case, what we see is an economy that is capable of fast growth. It is one of the largest economies in the world, but it's also susceptible to pretty pronounced and exaggerated downside volatility. And because of the importance of an economy to a state's credit rating, what we find is that over time, state credit ratings do correlate with the performance of a state's economy, and also almost as importantly, its fiscal condition. And so because of this, people will ask me, as an analyst that covers the state, they will say, well, is California really only better off because it's benefiting from the byproduct of a cyclical upswing? And will we be right back into the same kind of fiscal crisis that we were in 2009 and 10? And I think the answer to that question really can be found in looking at the credit rating itself. In late 2010 and 2011, when Governor Brown took office, the credit rating on the state was A-. It was the lowest rated state in the country at the time. Since then, the state's rating has moved up to AA-, three full notches, a full category, a more pronounced recovery than any other state in the nation from the Great Recession. At the same time, we still have a rating that's lower than 41 other states. So, you know, there's still a lot of vulnerabilities that we see in our work on the state's credit. And, you know, all of that being said, I think there have been some steps that have been taken. When Senator De Leon was talking about the amicable nature of the state legislature, I couldn't help but recall, it wasn't that long ago, that it wasn't that way. In fact, California was held up as sort of there were articles about, is California the next Greece? You know, this kind of thing. And in 2010, we didn't pass a budget until October 8th. And so the Proposition 25 enabling a majority vote budget is an institutional change that will probably benefit the state in the future, even in the next downturn. Proposition 2 that requires the state to deposit money into its rainy day fund. It also discourages the state from budgeting to its revenue peaks. There have also been changes in the way the state has, there is a change to the term limits and top two primary voting, things like this that probably have smoothed out the relationship there. But we really think that those changes alone will not be enough to prevent pretty significant fiscal stress in the next downturn. Remember that California gets 67% of its revenue from personal income taxes. Of those personal income taxes, the top 1% of income taxpayers paid 48% of the income tax. So,
thank you.
It lends.
Thank you.
Thank you, really.
Thank you, Mimi.
I guess my point with it just really is that I'm sure people can make good arguments about the progressiveness, if it's too progressive or not, but from our standpoint, it makes for a volatile revenue structure, and it has made it more difficult for the state to navigate the ups and downs of the economic cycle, probably more so than what we see in other states, and we have some other information I can talk about as we go through this discussion, but.
Amy, you had a question?
Yeah, when you're looking at the ratings for Standard & Poor's for California, do you take into account the unfunded pension liability that the state has? Because we have, when I was in the state legislature, it was about $500 billion, depending on what analysis you looked at. I mean, it's a substantial unfunded liability. So how does that weigh in to your analysis?
Well,
I just want to make a comment, maybe to pick up on that. A number of the largest taxpayers in the state of Illinois, almost all of them have recently bought homes in Florida. Because they believe, because you can't do anything, and even legislation that was passed was thrown out by the state Supreme Court, that they believe at some point that Illinois only has one choice and a dramatic increase in taxes from that standpoint. And so I think this is an important point to address from that standpoint.
Well, I think it is also. It's probably even more of a source of stress for some of the local governments, but for the state itself, it is a large liability. And to Michael's point, I mean, some of the states actually have a worse situation. California's pension systems are about 70% funded, which is a roughly average when you look across the states. I'm also concerned about the unfunded retiree health care benefit liability that currently is $74 billion. Pretty much completely unfunded, and the state budget included $2 billion in appropriations for that liability. But from an actuarial standpoint, they really should be contributing closer to $6 billion for
that.
So,
Gabe, I just want to put that for our audience today in perspective. General Motors eventually went bankrupt because of its unfunded health benefits that they had promised retired workers. So, at the end, the company was essentially not operating for its current employees, its shareholders, its creditors, or even its customers. It was operating for this large group of retired workers, which was much larger than the group that was currently working. And so the health benefits are a significant factor also, which is why we want to get everyone healthier from that standpoint.
Gabe? Have an affordable health care
system. Gabe, I want to throw one other thing at you. If we could pull up slide 31. My first visit to S&P was in 1968. Gabe let me know he was not working for S&P in 1968. But if we could go to the slide, back to the slide, showing you the companies that are the most valuable in the world, slide 31 I have. We could, this is not the slide, if you can switch to it, Larry. So what we saw was many of the companies that were the largest companies in the state of California moved. And whether it was Atlantic Richfield or Union Oil or even Occidental Petroleum recently. But when you think about the credit of the state, it's very interesting today when the two most valuable companies in the world are Apple and Alphabet, Google. They are highly dependent on the ability of their people that work for them. Less likely to move than an energy or a natural resource company whose natural resources were actually not necessarily in the state. Facebook the same. And as you go down the list, Intel, Oracle, Facebook is the fourth most valuable company in the world today. And so when you think about this growth, whether it's Salesforce, whether it's Amgen, Qualcomm, and so on, do you take in consideration this strength of the state, you know, tied in with the type of company that's here that are highly profitable rather than commodity-driven type businesses?
We do. The state's economic and business base is one of its strengths. We've actually, however, been citing the problem of affordable housing more recently because some of these firms, even in the Bay Area and Silicon Valley, are increasingly, you know, just attracting the workforce and the service sectors that support those companies that you mentioned are having a hard time, you know, with their workers having adequate housing that they can afford. And we actually think that that in itself could be a drag on the state's economy. Even with all of the challenges that we talk about with California's regulatory environment and tax structure, it's still one of the higher ranked states in per capita business startups. It ranked 15th in the nation in 2014. And when you look at the number of jobs that come from business startups, it ranks 19th. And so we try to base our analysis on the data and yet at the same time maintain a forward orientation in looking at where we think the state's credit is headed, because the data are inherently backward looking. And so these are all challenges, and I think that, you know, California's got a good track record with these businesses that you had on this slide, but whether or not they can maintain that will depend on the caliber of its workforce and the ability to retain good workers.
Okay, going back to the strength of the educational system and higher ed, I think would be interesting, Gabe, if you could, to kind of give the audience a comparison of where California ranks versus other states. So its rating today, how would that be relative to other states in the United
States? It's still toward the bottom. We're still at AA minus, 41 states are rated higher. And if we go to slide six, one thing we have done recently is an analysis where we did a regression of the performance of all of the state's budgets, fiscal 2017 budgets, except Illinois, because they don't have a budget yet. But what we did in this is we said if there were a 2% decline in the GDP, a 2% increase in the unemployment rate, and a 25% drop in the stock market, we modeled out what would happen to general fund revenues in each of these states. And what you see here is that California remains vulnerable because of that volatility I mentioned. The state's revenues would come up $14.7 billion short of what the budget assumes. And currently, even with the very good efforts and the very commendable job that I think the governor and legislature have done in building up a rainy day fund and a budget reserve, you can see that the fiscal gap that would emerge in that scenario would still exceed the reserves that the state has accumulated. And so really, the state ranks about middle of the pack in its recession resilience, if you will. And the rating, I think, correlates with that.
Well, thank you, Gabe. So Scott, we'd like to go to you, not just as chairman of the California Center, but also from the standpoint as one of the world's leading investors. I want to congratulate you on winning the award as the leading fixed income investor in the world recently, from that standpoint. So let's look at the kind of the environment we live in today. And if we step back and think about, we have never had as much liquidity in the world as we have today. If you look at the companies in the United States from that standpoint and their liquidity, you see this enormous increase in liquidity. Apple at the start in 07, if we go back to that last slide, if Apple had only $15 billion in cash today, over $230 billion. And so when you look at what's occurred, here with this enormous increase in liquidity in our companies today. Today, there's $30 trillion in the world that's getting a rate of return between one and minus. And so as we look at the challenges, and it was attributed to Albert Einstein once that when asked the most powerful force in the world, he responded, compound interest. I guess his personal savings did not have the advantage of the programs that you had put in, Senator DeLeon. So we have these assumptions, and if we look at where the actual assumptions are today, many of them are still above 7%. So we're looking at 30 trillion that's yielding less than one. New York State local retirement system generated a rate of return of, in the last year, of 0.2%. Double B bonds are yielding 4% or 4.5%. So you really can't go into fixed income securities today and achieve these rates of return. And if you look at CalPERS, they had significant contribution to their rates of return from their private equity portfolio and their alternative portfolios. But today, the level of interest rates that you had predicted, Scott, would be low and would stay low for quite a while, don't provide large institutions that have significant actual assumptions to achieve those rates of return through credit investments. Where do we go here? How do we deal with these issues?
Well, you know, interesting, Mike. Interestingly, I just met with a state pension fund. They invited me to come in and spend the day with them to essentially talk about completely revamping their investment approach. The old model of a certain allocation to fixed income and a certain allocation of equities, they realized that that was just going to be a long process of falling behind the assumptions. And so, you know, they're looking at it in a different way, which is to say, okay, why don't we look at this based upon the risk in the asset and what the return would be? And so it leads them to do things they're considering a lot more in the area of infrastructure, private equity, things like this that, you know, with the right support, especially around infrastructure, you don't have the same volatility in returns, and they have a much higher chance of reaching their expected returns than they do by buying, you know, treasury, you know, notes that yield 1.5%.
So it's interesting. I had discussed this with Scott. I was just in Japan, and the government of Japan is extremely frustrated with their financial institutions and their companies, and that they've driven interest rates to zero or negative, and $17 trillion of their citizens' investments are yielding either zero or negative rates of return. Their companies have increased substantially their liquidity and have not invested, and today hold 1.25 times the GDP. And if you can see here, the United States liquidity in its companies has substantially increased from where you were in 2006, but still is small relative to Japan. And so they've been looking for these type of things. Where, how do they get their financial institutions to invest? And so they recently allowed their pension fund, $1.3 trillion, to sell $800 billion in Japanese government bonds and invest outside the country in search of a rate of return. And so this is obviously a challenge. One of the things I want to go to, Larry, if you could put up that slide that shows you value per employee. And I want to make this point again, that when you look at Facebook today, it has a value today of close to $25 million per employee, or Google. And Gabe, when you think about the companies, they can afford to pay their employees substantially more because their value per employee is so high. Now, if you go to Macy's at 100,000 employee, you're somewhat hamstrung at what you can do, or even Walmart. You can't offer a lot of additional benefits. So even though we have high housing prices in Silicon Valley, because of this enormous valuation in employee, whether it's housing subsidies, healthcare issues, these companies can offer substantial benefits to their employees that unfortunately other companies cannot offer today. I'd like to switch, if I could, to this area of the demographic changes in the state. And Senator, really, kind of your view of this issue as we look at it. We have California, as many of you know, almost everything that happens in the United States starts in California, both good and bad. Okay, but we've had this dramatic change today in our state's population. And today, only 25% of the children under 5 in the state of California are Caucasian. So it's inevitable here at this time, as you look at it, and you look at these percentages, if we can go back to the last slide, you could see that only Hawaii has a lower percentage of Caucasians that currently make up the state's population that are young. And this dramatic change, Mimi, that's coming, most of the states that are growing the population the most are about to go majority-minority. So the majority of the people in those states will be either African-American, Latino-Hispanic, or Asian. How do you see our state in terms of these dramatic changes in demographics?
I think that California is America before America is itself, which means we have to get it right in California. Obviously, the vast migration is attributed to the Western Hemisphere and the Pacific Rim. Unlike European migration vis-a-vis the Eastern Seaboard. So I think investments, key investments, K through 12 are absolutely critical and essential. Higher education is critical. And that doesn't mean a four-year private university exclusively, but that means career technical education in the community colleges, which I believe will actually play a much bigger role in my estimation than either the UC, the Cal States, or Stanford, Caltech, or a USC for continued economic growth to sustain folks in the middle class. But I do believe in a society that continues to be stratified based on race, gender, ethnicity, immigration status, geographical location, because obviously Silicon Valley is not the same comparison to the Inland Empire, comparison to Central Valley, Los Angeles, Orange County, and San Diego. That education is the greatest equalizer that we have. And continued and strategic right investments in both K through 12 as well as higher education are absolutely going to be key because of the rich mosaic, which I believe is our strength in California and for the entire nation, irrespective of the very polemic and polarizing presidential year right now. The diversity and the rich tapestry, the mosaic of the different ethnicities from all over the world is the strength of California. It's surely not a weakness in my estimation. That's why we have to get this done right, because we are America before America is itself and in many regards. And like you said, Michael, the good, the bad, as well as the ugly, whatever we export to the rest of the country and to the rest of the world. But again, let me just emphasize and underscore, highlight, italicized, bold, you know, with several explanation points behind it, you know, key investments in human capital, in education, are also going to be key for California. That, I believe, you know, and it isn't part of the methodology with regards to credit ratings, you know, but I think that overall, you know, our credit rating to continuously improve, we have to make the right investments. Therefore, you have an educated workforce. You have an economy that's growing. You know, balanced budgets, because we have 6 consecutive years of a balanced budget in California. You made reference to the rainy day fund, about $7 billion. We're paying down our budgetary debt. We've been quite successful at doing it. We're chipping away at it, and it's helping us move forward with our credit rating. But we're unlike any other state. We're like any other country in the world. I know that Canada, you know, is a very diverse, you know, country in comparison to the rest of the Western Hemisphere. Only the U.S. is much more diverse. But California, key investments are education.
I think that's a really key point for all to think about, that we are America before America is America. And I think we're going to give you full credit for that phrase.
Do you mind?
Mimi, I just wanted to ask one. Gabe, go ahead. Then
well, I was just going to ask the senator, when we think about the upcoming legislative session and the types of investments you mentioned, and also with bearing in mind the state's still tenuous budgetary condition, really, how do you prioritize things, and how do you think about those, you know, educational priorities, and how do you balance them?
Well, and I just want to make one point. When we talk about education, we have a Nobel Prize winner, James Heckman, that pointed out that the highest return in education is in early child care education. So a dollar invested in a five-year-old, and unfortunately, at 5 years old, and he called it depressing accuracy, and a professor of Fuchs at Stanford pointed out, at two standard deviations, at five, you can predict who's going to be successful and who's not going to be successful. So I really wanted to show, this is your rate of return chart on education for a dollar invested. And obviously, the earlier you invest that money, the higher the rate of return. And a dollar in a five-year-old, you need $3 by 15, you need $5 by 22, and you need $10 by 30 to get the same output.
Now, you said it perfectly, Michael, and I couldn't have said it better in terms of early childhood education, preschool, these types. Believe it or not, and I think this is why it's working in California, because people don't conceptualize this. When you raise the minimum wage to $15 an hour, although controversial with some folks in this room probably, those who support it, those who are against it, when you raise the minimum wage, that has a positive, we believe, outlook for California. When you invest in the health care of undocumented children, that is a positive thing because you end up paying the cost in the ER room. When you move forward equal pay for women doing equal work, that improves the quality of life. This is not part of the methodology and part of the algorithms that one computes, whether it's Moody's or Standard & Poor's or Fitch for your credit rating, you know. But these are factors that actually improve the quality of life because people want to live in California, and it is expensive here, no doubt about it. Businesses want to relocate to California. We just got Proterra from South Carolina, a right-to-work state, a red state. We just moved to California. We just, Elon Musk just expanded even more so in Hawthorne. We have Mercedes-Benz just expanded down in Long Beach even more so because we do have a very strong educated workforce in California. And again, investments in education, but I can't stress enough because you said something that was really key that people don't really factor in. Early childhood education, ECE, is absolutely critical because you can predict. The two biggest predictors of a child's future are their parents' educational level and their income level. That being said, if you live in Santa Monica, if you live in Brentwood, if you live in Palo Alto or Menlo Park, it's an easy, predictable, you know, sort of pathway. Where are you gonna end up? If you come from Compton, East LA, where I grew up in Logan Heights in San Diego, it's also pretty predictable where you're gonna end up. And I don't like to say that I'm an outlier, but as the youngest child of a single immigrant mother with a third grade education who cleaned homes of hedge fund investors in the Tony environment of La Jolla, overlooking the panoramic views of the Pacific Ocean.
And a few biotech companies.
And a few biotech companies at the time, you know. It wasn't by the sheer grit and resiliency and determination, this Kevin's such a genius, he's an outlier, look at him. No, no. There were policies that were put in place that actually took a chance on someone like me and others like me, because my story is not a unique story. So you have to have these policies, and it's just like Malcolm Gladwell, it debunks this myth of you're such a genius because, you know, well, no, you grew up in Palo Alto. You had the network that got you access to venture capital. You know, you grew up in Santa Monica or elsewhere, or in Laguna Beach, you know, and stuff like that, you know, and, you know, so that's, you have to disrupt, if you will, the status quo. To move policies with intentionality, to make sure you democratize. And let me one case in point. What we're doing in our climate change policies is unlike any part of the world right now. Because we're actually reducing carbon, because we're 28% less carbon intensive. And we have grown this economy by making sure we democratize our climate change policies, by making sure people of color and those at the lowest economic strata have access to distributed generation solar technologies on their rooftop. Because if only the early adopters, those who have the financial wherewithal in their pocket, can adopt early, because irrespective of what the price point is, they have the money to burn to get the latest and greatest and best and cleanest technologies. We'll never meet our macro goals, and we'll never really promote economic growth unless you make sure everyone at the every economic strata has access. So that means if you have money for a Tesla and a charging station, good for Elon Musk. However, until you democratize and make these rebates available to all individuals from East LA all the way to Santa Monica Bay, we'll actually never have real economic growth. And that's why we're moving our policies with intentionality, unlike Japan, France, the European Union, or any other nation in the world. And it is working because we can quantify, verify, and actually measure real economic growth in energy efficiency space, in the DG space, in the manufacturing of the clean technologies. We will be, once again, I predict, a manufacturing hub, advanced manufacturing, because it's a little disingenuous to say, you know, California has lost its manufacturing base because complete overregulation. It's called globalization, and it's called advancement of technology. And it's happened in every other state and every other part of the world as well.
I want to pick up on this technology issue that you've put forth. And Mimi, you've often talked about California as a state of dreamers and innovators. How do we keep that?
Well, we need to make sure that we stay competitive. And even though we are, we have Silicon Valley here, we also, places like Texas, have a lot of technology companies. Colorado has a lot of technology companies. And we can't lose that competitive edge. And I take it back again to tax reform. We have to make sure that our businesses are competitive and that we have a competitive tax structure in place. Because corporations are going to do what they have to do. And if they have to move, they have to move because of they can't be competitive. So I would just take it back to us. We need to be mindful about the competition out there. And we can't just say, because we're the fifth largest economy, we're doing terrific. Because
we're not investing on our laurels either.
We're
investing in education.
But I have to go back to the regulation, because we don't only see overregulation in the state of California, we see it from a government level as well, in the federal government. We have government agencies who are regulating and making decisions that Congress is supposed to be making, and that is hurting businesses across the country. We have to rein in our regulation from a national standpoint as well. In fact, we put forward a piece of legislation that said, for every regulation a government agency puts forward that's going to cost us $100 million, Congress has to make a decision if that regulation moves forward or not. You look at England. England was so overregulated, they made a decision where for every new regulation they're putting forward, they have to undo two pieces of regulation. So England's figured it out. If we don't cut down on our regulatory burdens that we are placing on businesses, we are going to become less competitive. And we have to take that very seriously. And we have to look at the laws, and we have to look at what the Department of Labor is doing. And the cost of labor is very, very expensive. We have to look at what our government agencies are doing and what they're trying to impose on our businesses.
I'd like to go back, if I could, and just pull up this formula I wrote in 1965 at Berkeley. And this was after the Watts riots. And our theme for our global conference this year is going to be a meaningful life. And I think you touched on this issue in many ways. What are the jobs? What are the jobs in the terms of technology? And as you think about the range of jobs being eliminated, today we had a significant presentation on technology and transportation. And in 20 to 30 states, the number one job is driver, whether I'm driving forklifts, truck, cars, taxis, or an Uber driver, or Federal Express, DHL. So when they open the paper in the morning and they hear about driverless vehicles, they're thinking, what's my job in the future? And today, if you're a portfolio manager, Scott, of actively managed equities, new labor laws require you, if you've suggested a money manager of fund, even if it has the best performance that charges a higher fee, a small business is held accountable for suggesting that. And so as we look at this, one of the things that Senator De Leon has stressed is the social capital that exists. So when you think back about forms of social capital that exist, one of them is the environment. And so we see today in China that 60% of the wealthiest people in the country want to leave. Now, whether they want to leave for religious freedom, whether they want to leave for the environment, whether they want to leave for property rights, and the number one destination they want to come to is the United States, and the number one state they want to come to in the United States is California. And so we are extremely attractive in this sense to the people from the world because of our social capital. This is not on our balance sheet, okay? Right. We don't carry these things on the balance sheet, just like we don't carry, if we go back to that formula, we don't carry human capital on the balance sheet today. And these are key elements as we think about our future and what are the jobs going to be. And whether it's agriculture or whether 90% of all the jobs in finance have been eliminated with technology today from that standpoint. And so when we think about these issues, I think it's very important we think about what's going on in that household and what's important to them. So Scott, have you got a solution for what the jobs are of the future? You've done so well in so many other areas. What are they? What are the companies that you want to finance to supply capital to that are going to be these jobs of the future? What should we tell Mimi and Senator De Leon right now about what we should be focused on in job creation?
Well, biotech is going to be a huge part of the future, right? Technology, especially the areas of AI, big technology. I'd like to say alternative fuels, especially solar, but Mike, the thing I don't understand is why should I put a solar panel on my house because 3 years from now, it'll produce 50% more energy, right? So I don't know how you make that play. But I think that it is gonna be challenging, but one of the things that I find interesting in this whole discussion today, when we were listening to Lyft and the discussion about autonomous driving, technology has always been a threat. And the reality is that technology has brought us better, higher standards of living, better ways of life. And there's a discussion, I know, in the current administration about the idea that we're gonna have to come up with a way to pay people that lose their jobs because of AI or something else. And I thought to myself, why are we doing that? Why doesn't everybody just work a shorter work week? And I wouldn't mind working, well, you and I, Mike, will work however long we have, but the average person, I think, wouldn't have a problem with a 10-hour work week and having robots do all the things, the menial tasks that they used to do, and, enjoy
Scott, the
standard
did you
of living.
See that movie WALL-E?
No.
Okay, where, people didn't even walk in the future, they had a little thing carrying them around. I'm not sure. I used to put up this sign that when they showed studies that you had higher probability of a heart attack if you went on vacation, okay? I'm not sure that 10-hour work week is the solution. Many wives would tell their husbands, what are you doing here? Get out of the house, okay? So, but I think if we go back and look at that slide on technology and just think about these challenges. Now, Marcus, one of the great potential here is the potential of genomics today and the costs falling and going something that cost $1 billion now costing $1,000 and someday, and precision medicine on our doorstep today where we could treat a person and know that it's going to work before we give it to you. So, I think you have to be excited about the future of technology in treating patients from that standpoint.
Yeah, we're very excited about that, we're actively involved with working with providers who are really trying to drive the adoption of those technologies where they're evidence-based. So, and we're also actually, we've developed a coverage with evidence development policy where we're able to partner with academics and other technology innovators to test promising, what I call socio-technical innovations in healthcare that are scalable, so that we can take an emerging intervention that we think is very promising, it addresses an important healthcare issue, test it more rapidly by actually covering some of those investigational services you might otherwise consider not investigational because the evidence isn't developed enough, but we want to accelerate the development of that evidence. So we have actually our first pilot is with UCSF and the Breast Cancer Center there, and they're using genetic tests to evaluate women's risk of developing breast cancer, so we can pilot, we can study the use of a risk-adjusted breast cancer screening protocol as opposed to just screen everybody in the same way. So we're looking for more opportunities like that. And we think that there's a lot of inefficiency in healthcare now that evidence-based genetic testing will help us eliminate, and we'll get to a higher value healthcare system.
Not to be a downer, but I mean, of course, the more successful Marcus is, the worse our pension problem is, right? Because everybody will be living longer.
We're living longer, and, right. Yeah.
And I just want to say that I saw a headline in the Sacramento Bee a few years ago that 25% of the jobs in Sacramento were in healthcare, and I actually thought that was a bad thing, because I somehow labor under the delusion maybe that healthcare is like sucking up all the jobs as other jobs disappear, that people go into healthcare and eventually we'll have half the population taking care of the other half of the population. And that doesn't sound like a desirable end state to me. So I'm actually curious whether other people see it that way or people like the idea that we should have more and more healthcare jobs.
Well, the robots will do it.
Robots will do it, yeah.
I think one of the things we know is that wellness will play a larger role. And whether it's the food chain, whether it's what you drink, whether it's exercise, or whether it's massage therapy, it will play a much larger role in the past. So in closing with our panel today, I'd like to come back and have everyone give us one idea of what's going to keep California growing. Scott?
I'm going to say the creative minds of the people in California.
And why did you come to California?
Well, I came here for lifestyle. You know, I'd lived in London, I lived in New York, I came here at 37 and decided to completely start life over. California is a perfect place to live, and I'm happy to pay the extra 3% that Proposition 55 is going to keep in place.
You said it publicly.
I don't think it's 3. It's 3.8.
Oh, yeah, no, that's right.
Plus the you can't deduct 6%, right? The California has that on. So it probably works out a little bit higher.
Well, you're right. But you do have a federal tax deduction for part of it.
But it is the environment and it is life.
That's right.
Senator?
There's a bunch of things. I'm going to be a little selfish and talk about SB 1234, retirement security. We have about 7 million Californians currently today who have no access to defined benefit, DB or DC, defined contribution, at their place of employment. That's 7 million Californians. So you imagine what it is nationwide. Starting maybe in 2018 when we go live, California will be the first state in the nation. It'll be the largest expansion of retirement security since the New Deal era with FDR in Social Security. Every Californian will automatically be enrolled in the California Secure Choice Act, which I authored and I created. I got the approvals with Department of Labor and the IRS and Department of Treasury in Washington, D.C. obviously, whether it's BlackRock or Vanguard or Prudential, Fidelity, they'll have
Guggenheim.
The ability, Guggenheim, you know, they can, State Street advisors, you know, they can come in and they can bid for the fund. It'll probably be worth about $8 billion in the first year. And the point is this, is that the vast majority of Californians who have no access to any type of retirement security, even if folks say the products exist out there, the reality is no one walks into Charles Schwab or pops open their laptop and goes and finds T. Rowe Price, and I'm going to buy me a 401k plan, I'm going to buy me a Roth IRA and IRA for retirement security. It's so ambiguous, you know, and abstract that folks are not in that employment space where they offer these types of benefits to begin with. But we all subsidize folks who retire into poverty, and of those who live in poverty today, of senior citizens, two-thirds of them are women. Two-thirds of the senior citizens who live in poverty today in California are women, and be mindful. These are not just women who are from the lowest economic strata. These are middle-income workers who retire when their backs, their arms, their shoulders, and their waist physically give out. So they don't have fixed assets. They don't have any types of assets or investments. So this will really change behavior modification, obviously, the psychology of forced savings, if you will. You know, you can opt out if you want, but I think this is going to be the future for the entire nation.
Mimi?
Well, I was born and raised in California, and one of the greatest strengths California has is the entrepreneurial spirit. And as long as government stays out of the way and allows our businesses and our entrepreneurs to flourish, we're unstoppable. But I think it's very, very important that we make sure that government does not get in the way of success.
Marcus?
You know, I was also born in California, and I would say—
But you wandered away for a while.
I did wander away. I went to Minnesota, but I came back. And I would say that one of the biggest changes I've seen in the state in the last 60 years is the incredible increase in the diversity of the population. And I find California to be a very vital and creative state, and I think that diversity is actually creating a lot of, it generates a lot of creativity, and I think that's actually one of the things that's going to keep California growing. I think it attracts talent. I think we're a talent magnet, and I also think we're a talent factory. And so I think we need to find a way to leverage that what I think is a real strength, and grow it. And I think Senator DeLeon's comment about California is the United States before. We're the United States before the United States is actually a very apt description of what's happening. And I think if we find a way to embrace that and use that as a strength, it will help the state continue to grow.
Gabe, what does California need for you to give it a higher rating?
Okay.
Well, maybe you left the legislature, yeah. Right? So that should go up a little bit.
More like our public servants here. I'm going with a massive increase in the supply of our housing stock and a major investment in infrastructure, looking for ways to leverage private institutional capital that's residing around the world that could be deployed in our state to make our whole exercise in commerce much more efficient. And so those are I'm going with two, housing and infrastructure.
One of the areas that came up on the panel today is the issue of retirement. And I think one of the things we've looked at the Milken Institute, it's very difficult to deal with this issue, but whether retirement should be a percentage of life expectancy. So if life expectancy is 80, maybe it should be 80% of life expectancy. And it's just hard to believe you're going to, since many of our own children haven't figured it out to 25 or 30, that you're not going to really get going to 25 or 30, and then at 50 or 55 you're going to retire, and you're going to live till 90. It's a pretty short period of time, and mathematically impossible to cover those costs. And so I think we need to think about jobs, lifelong jobs, as part of having a meaningful life. One of the areas we did not cover in the panel, I'd like to close there, is just a picture of some of the unbelievable natural wonders that California brings. And from my office, I can see snow on the mountain up in Big Bear or Lake Arrowhead and the Pacific Ocean. And it's really hard to put a price on that. And as we search here, Lake Tahoe, one of the two blue water lakes left in the entire world, and think about why you want to live here versus other places in the world, it is the beauty of the state and the beauty of the people that brings us all here. And thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for attending the California Summit. Please join us for a cocktail reception next door in the Tiffany Room. We look forward to seeing you again.